Hello, everybody, and welcome to today's webinar, Would You Water Your Garden with a Leaky Hose? Part two, From the Garden to the Harvest. Melissa and I are delighted to be here with you today to present what's going to be, you know, a great informative session on some data governance and data hygiene strategies with a focus on the health plan this time. Because if you all remember at Rise National, we focused generically on data hygiene and governance. So today we'll get to hear from Melissa and how she realized a great harvest from her risk adjustment garden. Let us introduce ourselves first. I'm Dawn Carter, and I'm a Director of Product Strategy at Centauri. I've been in healthcare for 28 years, which most recently includes developing products and services related to risk adjustment and general revenue integrity, also social determinants of health. And Melissa is the Director of Clinical Programs at Mountain Health Co-ops. And she has over 20 years of diversified experience in healthcare, including risk adjustment, medical management, and claims and payment integrity. So without further ado, let us get started. Just as a few tips before we proceed, all of our participant lines are muted. To protect your privacy, you'll only see your name and the presenter's names in the participant box. If you'd like to submit a question to us at any time, please do so in the chat. And to do that, in the event window in the panel's drop-down list, you know, select the appropriate prompts, type your question, and click send. And we will get to those questions at the end of the webinar. So let's do a little bit of throwback Thursday. Since it is Thursday and we're going to throw back to Rise National for any of you that were there, you may remember this slide. Have you ever found yourself or any of your risk adjustment leadership asking, why is our actual RAF so far off from our forecasted RAF? Also known as, why are we losing money? Also known as, why is our RAF so low but our claims cost so high? So today, we are going to be talking about, you know, how to answer those questions with confidence, and also when it's very useful when setting your KPIs and your metrics for risk adjustment to keep these questions in mind. And today we're going to focus on the health plan experience. At Rise, we focused on this generically in terms of developing yourself what's called a revenue leakage map and the appropriate KPIs and metrics. And today we're going to hear from a health plan that has done this just to give you all a sense of, you know, how they implemented these strategies and how it paid off for them. So I also presented at that time during RISE, and I do this at a lot of my presentations since I focus a lot on data governance and hygiene. I call this the iceberg metaphor. And the reason for this is because, you know, talking scientifically, scientists say that 90% of an iceberg lies under the water where it can't be seen. So, and when we look at this in terms of risk adjustment only counts for the visible portion of that iceberg, the little 10% that peaks out of the water. The rest is attributable to claims and other related administrative functions. And so these are the pre-adjudication functions, and risk adjustment is post-adjudication. And for all lines of business that risk adjust, it is rarely that 10% that sticks out of the water, the risk adjustment operations, that determines operational and financial success. It is all of the revenue cycle operations that precede risk adjustment. And you'll hear Melissa talk about that today. Every point of data transfer poses a risk to data completeness and accuracy, and this in turn affects risk adjustment payment accuracy. A lot of you who are at RISE National may also remember this slide, and hence the leaky hose that we talk about in the title. And this is just an illustration from a different viewpoint of the iceberg concept, but we're getting a little more granular and now talking about the completeness and the accuracy of data. So of course, in risk adjustment, when we look at the right-hand side of the screen, which is what's making it to CMS for Medicare Advantage, to the Edge server, to state Medicaid departments, we look at the nozzle end as that the risk adjustment operations. And then on the left-hand side, we have the claims universe. This is the faucet. And so this is everything that comes from providers that goes into the claims system for adjudication. So this is everything that could possibly be going, whether in Medicare Advantage, it's paid and denied. For Edge Server, it's paid, all the supplemental data, everything. And so, of course, along the way with our leaky hose metaphor, there could be leaks that cause revenue leakage. And typically, these are attributable to automation and configuration issues in your claims, enrollment, and provider systems administration areas. So notice risk adjustment is not there. Risk adjustment is on the right-hand side. So clearly, if you've got leaks in that hose, what comes out of the faucet is not getting to the risk adjustment destination. And so a lot of this leakage, and Melissa's going to talk some about this from a health plan perspective, is related to pended claims, inappropriate denials, especially in the case of the Edge server, appeals and adjustments, and any other claim that does not auto-adjudicate. So anytime you have something that's hanging up that claim in a system, that's a source of leakage that you need to track. And you can actually put a value on that using the risk model. So very important to do when you are trying to set KPIs and metrics for what's coming into the faucet is making it to the risk adjustment end. And then of course, on the risk adjustment side, making sure that you can validate that data against the rules where it's going, whether it's Medicare Advantage, Edge Server, State Medicaid, that you reconcile it and that you put a value on it so you can see exactly how much the data that's leaking is costing you. And now for our first polling question, just to keep things a little lively, we're gonna do some polling. Does your organization perform an operational revenue leakage analysis that quantifies the financial impact of automation and configuration issues at each point of data transfer, just like I talked about? And the answers are, of course, yes, no, and what does that even mean? And if you answer, what does that even mean? Never fear, we're going to be talking about some strategies today that you might start with so that you can answer those questions I talked about in that first slide. And we'll wait about 30 seconds to give everybody a chance to vote. And then our producer will put those results on the screen and we'll see where our answers lie here. Okay, so we have about 29% said yes, to which I say, right on, that's great. No, we have 33%, and then what does that even mean is 38%. All right, so without further ado, let's talk about how we can give some meaning to that. So today's topics at a glance, how our health plan decided that they'd had enough of leaky hoses and icebergs and underwent a leakage analysis, a high-level overview of how their analysis was conducted and what their analysis revealed, how they decided on the priority of addressing their leaks and how they answered those golden questions we talked about at the beginning, a discussion of the outcomes of their new strategies and of the most critical factors for their success, and how this analysis also enables health plan and provider education, especially for those that are new, to compare to industry best practices or those who need to understand how risk adjustment affects quality of care and population health. And now Melissa is going to talk about the harvest from her risk adjustment garden after she underwent such a leakage analysis. Take it away, Melissa.
Thanks, Dawn. With that, I thought I'd share with you some of the reasons why our health plan opted for a very holistic evaluation of our risk adjustment program and some of the areas we concentrated on. The team was really newer to their roles, and it was a great opportunity not only to have that 100,000-foot view, but also a really deep in-the-weeds evaluation of our associated processes. So when you're doing really well in areas, you also know there's always that room for improvement. I was really looking for a benchmark against industry standards and a compass point to direct us towards. And I think really everyone has that iceberg, like we saw earlier in the slide. No matter how well you're doing really well in risk adjustment, there's always areas that are unseen that need attention, and you're likely leaking financial gains. Next slide, please. Some of the areas that may not be top of mind when it comes to risk adjustment program and you're leaking data might be pended claims, member enrollment, using specific resources that are available to you, creating and maintaining audit trails, standard operating procedures, that strong provider engagement program, and quarterly business reviews with your vendors. So I'm going to spend some time going over each of these areas for you deeper in depth. Next slide, please. The first one I want to talk to you about is really claim pens. Pended claims are probably one of the most heightened areas of concern. As Dawn spoke at the RISE conference, knowing your auto adjudication rates is probably the most imperative problem for success in your RA program. So are you auto adjudicating anywhere between 40 and 60%, 60 to 80, more or less? Do you even know? So if you're not auto adjudicating your claims, they're pending for some reason or another. And then the question becomes, how many pen reasons do you have and who's managing those pen queues for you? The other question is, do your pens stack? And that means, does one pen rely on another to release before the other pen can release? So that often occurs when your pen claims are sent externally to vendors for maybe pen integrity reviews, medical necessity reviews, and then you tack on TPL. That's kind of a mess. So then you need to have a designated person who understands the importance of claims timeliness as well as that risk adjustment timeliness, and that's crucial. And so here's the reason why. So if you think of your Edge server timeline and then Medicare sweeps, when claims are pended in multiple queues and there's no one monitoring that matrix for claims, you will most certainly miss that deadline to submit claims to CMS for your RA program. And this has happened. So million-dollar claims with high-dollar RAF scores are missed being loaded to Edge or sweeps because no one's watching that hen house. Next slide, please. We have another polling question for you. And Dawn, do you want me to take this or do you want to take it?
I can take it. All right.
Go ahead.
So about pens, how many pen reasons does your claims adjudication system currently have? None. We reject or deny anything that does not pass validation. Less than 10, more than 10, but fewer than 20, more than 20, or I don't know. And we'll give about 30 seconds for folks to answer, and our producer will put our results up there. And if you don't know, it's okay, because a lot of times, you know, many people are like, oh, that's in the claims department. I don't need to worry about that. But as we go about this webinar, you'll see why you do, and you need to have a really close relationship with that claims department in order to realize risk adjustment success. Okay. So we have 0% at none. We reject or deny anything that doesn't pass validation. And I will say that's usually the case. You know, most health plans have at least some pen reasons. I do know a couple that don't. They just flat out reject anything that doesn't pass. Less than 10 is 6%. More than 10, but fewer than 20 is 0%. More than 20 is 11%. And I don't know is 83%. So like I said, if you don't know, that is okay. But definitely, if you are experiencing some issues, wondering why what's coming out of that faucet is not getting to the nozzle end of risk adjustment, you want to take a look at your claims. All right, Melissa. Well, with that, we'll just proceed right on to the next slide.
Perfect. Thank you. So another area I want to talk about is enrollment. And you may not think about this as closely for risk adjustment in regards to our NICU babies. So on the ACA, there is some states that require auto enrollment or auto coverage for the first 30 days of life. And if you are not monitoring these, and if you aren't enrolling them in your plan for in regards to the edge service business rules, you're missing out on capturing those high dollar claims in your enrollment and on your edge server business rules. So those are really monitoring those, getting those onto your edge server. So like I said, the ACA market, the edge server business rules, those have very specific instructions for enrollment for those newborns. So your health plan can collect the claims data diagnosis onto your server. It's also important to engage into your care management teams, to engage in the parents to provide support and assist the enrollment process onto your plan in a timely manner. You know, this is a really stressful time for parents. Navigating healthcare is hard. So as a plan, it's really our job to help support those members through all aspects of care. Again, many can say that this is really not that risk adjustment department role. However, as I discussed later, RA touches so many departments. And in our area, that risk adjustment claims and care management, we all work in tandem. So make sure that you're watching that area of enrollment. Next slide, please. Another area I want to talk about is resources. So oftentimes, we really depend on our internal reporting to ensure we have a tight RA program and that we are submitting all of our appropriate claims to the Edge server or to CMS. For HHS CMS risk adjustment program, the use of the FFM, RA, RAI payments or charge reports are available to each health plan. That's a really crucial step to decreasing your Edge server data submission errors, reducing orphan claims, resolving your error codes and reviewing the transfer payment reports. Really getting insight into those edge server responses, your acceptance rates, rejections, and your orphan claims really enabled us to manage this process throughout the year and track to a solid year end. So don't forget about the supplemental diagnosis submissions, whether you're capturing those through either the prospective, concurrent, or retrospective reviews. Supplemental files can actually increase your risk transfers between 4% and 6%. So those are very important. And next slide. So I've detailed here some of the ACA reports that are available that I find most helpful when analyzing our edge server submission files. Using a vendor for edge submission is pretty common, and we use those that are supplied from our edge server vendor, but also from FFM. Those that work in Medicare line of business, this is the same as your MA02 and MA04 and the 837 responses. Those are similar reporting tools for you. Use those as validation for linking claims, orphan claims, error reporting, and such. And then those in the Medicaid line of business, each state provides reports, and those vary. However, those reports all provide that same similar responses to validate your error reporting, linking, and orphan claims. The important takeaway here is that you're using those resources provided to you and then taking action based on those findings. And next slide, please. The other area that we concentrated on was an audit trail. So risk adjustment, like I said before, does not function in a silo. For us, if you draw like a large circle in the middle of a page and then label that risk adjustment, for you, how many circles could you draw around it that have some sort of relationship either directly or indirectly with that program? If you think long and hard, almost every department in a health plan or even provider's office, either directly or indirectly, relate to an RA program. Now think about the audit trail from that. Can you map it so that if you were to have an issue with any of those areas, could you pinpoint where the data from that area is getting lost or leaked? I would say probably not. Most organizations do not have a transparent map that showcases the process and how each department interrelates. But this is how you ensure your data integrity is solid. Think about the one mail process for an RA claim. When a member mails in a claim or a provider mails in a claim, how many different ways can that claim be submitted and where do they go from there? A mapped process for each area and department should be created all the way through to CMS or your Edge server submission. When the CFO, like Don says, why are the claims so high and the RAF is so low, you can start digging into your mapped process for that, where that, what I call is a critical control point and where those leaks might be occurring. Next slide, please. So I know this is really small, but this is an example of what a process map looks like from one area to the other. Each department has a lane, a decision point, and those are identified. I call them critical control points or CCPSs. This term actually comes from manufacturing. It identifies a place in the process where critical issues could occur and are most likely to occur. And in the case of risk adjustment, this is likely where those diagnoses are stripped, claims are entered incorrectly, pens get lost, any process where you are likely to lose your data. Next slide, please. Some of the most integral areas to map, I've identified six here. We've got claims, provider services, appeals, enrollment, edge, and vendors. Those are probably the ones that I would say you are probably the most important to map. But if you also have transparency into your clearinghouses, go all the way back to your clearinghouse. This can be the very advantageous as well, having knowledge of the volume and types of claims that are being rejected at the clearinghouse. How many are then resubmitted, never resubmitted, can be valuable information. Claims that are never resubmitted can then provide you with information about your provider education, loss of dollars, as well as opportunities, linking that back to quality of care, coordination for the member. Next slide, please. And then I want to talk a little bit about provider engagement. I think this is probably one of the other things that is most very important. Effective provider engagement program is often driven by the quality of education, collaborative efforts, transparent communication between the provider and the payer. There's already, I think, a level of distrust and skepticism on the provider side towards payers. Usually it's that feeling of not being fully transparent, or their level of reimbursement may not be what it should be for the level of care that they, meaning the payer, is requiring. So coming together to understand their pain points, the provider's pain points, that transparent data regarding their patients, how both parties can help each other to provide safe, cost-effective care, and really ultimately driving patient satisfaction. I think that is probably the most important thing. I think to effectively facilitate collaborative transparent communication loop, quarterly face-to-face meetings should be scheduled at the beginning of the year, a January. Start putting those on your calendars with your providers, provider groups, health systems. And during these meetings, I think some of the topics that I would recommend to discuss, any emergency, emerging risks, quality, care management, coding topics, give them a voice to voice satisfaction, any concerns, solutions to issues that they may have. Share best practices between the both of you, review clinic, provider-specific data, trends in their data, and then set goals for those next meetings. Make it a productive meeting and not you as a payer talking to them. It has to be a back and forth communication. Next slide, please. Here's an example. I've got some provider report cards that I think are helpful. One is gap reporting, RAF data. I think that that helps accurate capture of member risk. It improves quality gap in care. And then obviously the two combined increase revenue and quality of care between the two. And as we all know, statistically, that top 30% of plan membership drives really 90% of the cost, right? Those are the sickest members. So targeting providers that manage these members, as well as providers who have that high, low, and then outlier risk scores is essential to capturing gaps and also those educational opportunities. So providers who are well-versed in risk adjustment will identify as those with the highest number of documented HCCs and closed gaps in care. Those identified as the low performers may need additional education on risk adjustment and documentation practices. Outlier providers are an area of concern as they will prove to be either questionable overuse and undocumented use of HCCs or critically low volume documented HCCs that don't correlate with their patient mix. Combining two strategies to identify provider targets allows a health plan to focus on the highest likelihood of a return on investment for risk improvement of the quality of care. And as we have all heard from OIG, audits are coming. Plans should be self-auditing for claims with high-risk diagnoses such as acute stroke, myocardial infarctions, vascular claudication, embolisms, and cancers in the outpatient setting, to ensure their active diseases and active care is being provided. In addition, diagnoses that are typically treated with medications, but you don't have any corresponding prescriptions that are found, those are red flags for the OIG, and they should be red flags for you as a plan. And then those are major depressive disorders and vascular disorders, embolisms. Be proactive and self-audit. In total, I think the OIG identified over $30 million in overpayments from six Medicare health plans since 2021. Don't be on the list. Be proactive and self-audit yourself. Next slide, please. QBRs, quarterly business reviews. Let's talk about vendor management. I know everyone is at a point of being tired of dealing with vendors. A colleague of mine told me not long ago they had quote unquote vendor fatigue and they were just over it. Just let them handle it. All I can say is just don't do this. I think that is the wrong thing to do. All I can say, you know, vendors, albeit are cumbersome, they are a great asset when you manage the relationship correctly. But you have to be willing and a collaborative partner to your vendor. If you are a hire a vendor, wash your hands of the process type of person, let them handle everything and you just check in every once in a while, you will most definitely fail. Whatever it is, whatever process or project you are vendoring. Some of the key things to get the most out of your vendors for RA, if you vendor any or all of it in risk adjustment, one of the things I recommend is designating a primary person responsible for that account. And that individual has to have full responsibility for that vendor and the program. Don't split the vendor account and program. It, most importantly, perform quarterly business reviews. make sure the appropriate stakeholders are at the table from both sides, finance, operations, clinical, your execs, whoever has to be there, make sure they are at the table every single time. Quarterly business reviews provide a measurable stick kind of on how well that vendor is performing, the good, the bad, the ugly, discuss strategies, obstacles, challenges, whatever is going on, but also plan for future growth, changes in direction. Do you need to pivot? Preview any upcoming product, tech improvements. What's going on financially with the vendor? Are you doing well? Are you doing poorly? If your vendor's not already doing this for you, ask them to start now. A quarterly cadence with those above discussion points, it's better to have the knowledge of what's going on earlier in the year instead of at the year end when you can't change your strategy and you're stuck and you're losing money. So this is really kind of a good thing to do. I highly recommend it. Next slide, please. So those are kind of the things that we have started doing. I want to talk about the end results that we've had. The ability to really have an unbiased review of our RA program and just put it out there really helped move us in the right directions. I think oftentimes the health plan may internally know the hidden opportunities they're facing, but having that individual with no ties to your process, dissect it, and then lay it out sometimes is the best course of action. This process can bring to light areas of need for those that require additional information, possibly to increase budgets or understand the RA program in its entirety, or just educate new team members. I've said this many times, but risk adjustment really is an iceberg and it does not function in a silo. As we've discussed, the program touches almost every department in the health plan and it's married partner to STARS and HEDIS. Some of the end results we've had significantly increased our overall plan and member RAF scores. We've had 99% acceptance in our EDGE server submissions. We've orphan claims we've linked to higher greater than 75%. We've completely eliminated our quality and our quantity outliers. We're now allowed and budgeted to hire additional staffing to support our provider education and outreach. We've started vendor QBRs, completely improved our relationships with our vendors. Our high dollar claims submitted now timely through our EDGE submissions because someone is watching our claims process. We have completed a transparent audit trail of the claims process, all associated departments, including completed standard operating procedures. So if it's ever audited, we can lay this out there for anyone. And we've had significant improvement in our risk transfer payments coming in. In addition to the great successes I've just listed here, we have improved and are now a four-star plan rating. So as I say, it links to HEDIS and STARS measures. That's it, John. That's for me. I'm going to pass it over to you.
Wonderful. Thank you, Melissa, especially for sharing those results. An evaluation like you described is not an easy one to undergo. And how I know that is because I performed these evaluations for health plans, but it is so necessary just to shine that light into every nook and cranny and find those leaks and then to close them so that you can have the gains that you described. So thank you for sharing that with our audience. So for a few moments, I just wanted to talk about, those of you might be asking, gosh, how do I implement such a program? Where do I start? Well, luckily, all health plans, regardless of the line of business, whether you're Medicare Advantage, you're commercial with the EDGE server, or even Medicaid, you'll have some tools at your disposal. Like we talked about, some reporting that's available, for example. So, and I look at data governance in terms of having a concurrent approach and a retrospective approach. Very similar to how we approach risk adjustment, concurrent and retrospective. So the reason for that is, with the concurrent portion, you can manage, in real time so that you are never surprised by what you see on the reporting that comes from CMS, the EDGE server, or wherever your data is going. So for your concurrent programs, a good place to start is by like Melissa described, mapping out that claims and encounter universe. All of your data sources, whether they're clearinghouses, the providers direct to the health plan, the mail, wherever it's coming from, map all of those processes and map that full process of a claim as it makes its way through adjudication and then to risk adjustment to the destination, whether it's CMS or HHS, and back again. And that is a good place to start because that's going to illuminate where your leaks are. And you can, where that data transfer point is, that critical control point, and something's not making it to the next, you can dig down into that root cause and address it as to why it's not making it to the next step. Also, you know, I call that, you know, developing a leakage map. And it's important also, as I said before, you know, at each of those critical control points, those data transfer points, to value them in terms of risk adjustment dollars, because money talks. And if you're having a problem getting some help for doing a concurrent and retrospective strategy, start here by saying, look how much money we're losing. If we invest in the right people, processes, and technologies, we can prevent X amount of dollars from not making it to the edge server in time and affecting transfer payments, or in Medicare Advantage, not making it by the sweeps deadlines and affecting the risk adjustment dollars. Also, you know, if you focus on nothing else, take a look at those orphan claims and orphan diagnoses. And you'll see a slide here coming up on the questions to ask yourself. If you do nothing else, find out why you don't have a claim for every diagnosis and why every diagnosis doesn't have a claim. Because you want to have the most complete set of data, because those diagnoses are what matters going to that destination. So you want that universe to be as complete as possible, so that nozzle end, the risk adjustment end, has got the most complete set of data and accurate set of data it can have. Now, retrospectively, of course, you want to use the reporting that comes from CMS and HHS. And Medicare Advantage, this is your quarterly report cards that come. And there's an example of one over on the right-hand side of the screen. Usually these come through the MARC system and the plans download them. So if you are using a vendor, you want to be sure that you're downloading those. And to Melissa's point, engage that vendor. Make sure, because this is a reflection of how well they're doing as well. So be sure you're sharing that with your vendors and all interested parties, including your provider. Also, in Medicare Advantage, CMS issues annual performance metrics, and these come in July. So these are additional metrics that relate to completeness and accuracy of data. And of course, for commercial, you have a wealth of reporting and FM community that can help you retrospectively manage your data governance. And if you're using entities like Wakely and Truven and Milliman, they often, you know, provide some additional metrics that relate to data completeness and accuracy as well. So be sure that you are using those reports to the best of your ability as well for your retrospective strategy. Now, Melissa talked some about provider enablement, and I look at, I call this non-clinical documentation improvement, because of course, in risk adjustment, you know, we talk a lot about clinical documentation improvement, which addresses medical necessity denials and documentation. So this is everything else that affects that data that's within the provider's control, because let's face it, claims come from providers. And so whatever's going through that nozzle end, that came from a provider somewhere previously. And so here's some of the things you might want to consider, because again, you might be like saying, where do I start? Now, this is a lot. Where do I start? So I always say start developing some risk adjustment data profiles for your providers. We do a lot of member profiling in terms of their RAF, you know, their chronic conditions, outreach that's been done, medical management, things of that nature. We want to do something similar for our providers. And so from a data standpoint, it's a good idea to look at the average number of diagnoses per claim and encounter and compare that to other providers and practices with the same and different EMR and EHR systems. The reason is truncation of diagnoses is a real thing, and it's a real bad thing, because a lot of providers may just be sending one diagnosis per claim because that's all they say, that's all their EMR will support. Well, that's not good in the world of risk adjustment. We want to be capturing as much as the member has. So it's important to make sure that we don't have some truncation happen, or perhaps you see a provider that consistently sends four all the time and no more than that. So do some comparisons. Also, take a look at the average number of denials from the providers and break it down by the reason. And then take a look at the percent of those that are overturned versus industry, kind of the industry deadlines, to see what might be missing the deadline because it's stuck in some sort of an appeal queue or a pen queue. This is very important. This tells you a lot about the data quality that comes from providers if you're looking at their denials, particularly for the edge server, since you cannot send those to the edge server. Also, professional claims for institutional services that have no institutional claim associated with it. As Melissa alluded to a little earlier, the OIG has been very quietly since 2018 conducting audits on high-risk diagnosis codes. And one of the things they look at when they're choosing the claims for the conditions that she looked at is similar to this, where you've got, you know, you've had some sort of a prescription for a medication, or there's a treatment, but there's no institutional service. There's no claim for, in the case of the cancers, like chemotherapy, radiation. Doing those types of comparisons will help you see a lot about the data quality there. Also, take a look at your clean claim averages versus industry deadlines and the percent that you lost because you couldn't get the claims into the Edge server or for Medicare Advantage by the deadline because they weren't clean coming from the providers. And a lot of times you see these being resubmitted and resubmitted multiple times, but no correction is happening. So take a look at your clean claim average. Also, take a look at your timely filing versus industry deadlines and the percent that you lost because those providers couldn't get the claims in on time due to data quality issues, or because the claim is stuck in your system because it is pended, it's stuck in an appeal queue, or somewhere else that it can't be released for risk adjustment. Also important is to look at your claims capture of diagnosis codes. So you want to see, you know, the percent of your diagnoses that are on your original claims versus your supplemental data. This is important for all risk adjusting lines of business, but particularly important because for Medicare Advantage, you know, CMS has made it very clear that they're not real fond of unlinked chart reviews. That could be a whole webinar in and of itself. So you want to make sure that as much as possible, you get those diagnoses on those original claims. And again, that comes from taking a look at what the provider is sending on the original claims, what they're documenting, that's important, and then what they're sending. And then also take a look at your high need beneficiaries. These are ones with at least 3 HCCs, and take a look at what diagnoses are coming in for them. That also gives you a nice little place to start. If you're kind of like, oh, where do I start? Start on those high need ones and work backward from there. So those are just some things you can start with if you're wondering how you implement your retrospective and concurrent data governance strategies. And now for our last polling question. Does your organization do any of the non-clinical documentation improvement activities that we mentioned on the prior slide? First choice is yes, we do all of them and then some. Second is yes, we do all of them. Third, no, we only do a few of them. And fourth is no, we do none of them. So we'll give about 30 seconds for an answer, and our producer will put our results up there. Hopefully you all are doing some of them, but if not, that's okay, because hopefully now you've got some actionable strategies between what I outlined and some of the things that Melissa indicated, you know, boded some success for her organization. All right, and our results should be coming up here shortly. All right, 7%, yes, we do all of them and then some. That is wonderful. Kudos and great job. Yes, we do all of them, also kudos. No, we do only a few of them at 60%, 33% was the prior one. That's good too, doing a few is better than doing none. And then luckily we have 0% is no, we do none of them. So it looks like there's some activity going on out there with some of these strategies, which is great. And hopefully this webinar will help you employ a few more. So as our key takeaway, as we bring our webinar today to a close, hopefully you've gotten some tools and some strategies that you can consider for your organization. And I always, when I do webinars that talk about leakage analysis and these maps, I like to say, ask yourself these golden questions. Why don't you have a claim for every diagnosis? And why don't you have all of the diagnoses on the claims? If you start with those two questions and work backward, you'll be in a really good spot to implement the correct concurrent and retrospective strategies for your organization. So if you learn nothing else today, hopefully you can take away these golden questions and work backwards from them and develop your own strategies that turn into that great risk adjustment harvest that we talked about in the beginning. And now we would like to open the floor for questions. If anybody would like to ask any questions, you know, the chat is open. So we will take a look and see what we have. It looks like we've got a question. Melissa, this one's going to be for you about the QBR process. So Katie Anderson asks us, I would love to know more about the QBR process. Were SLAs established for each vendor and a part of the QBR review? And then she also asks, and Melissa, you can also answer this too, and I'll chime in maybe afterwards. She asks, I'd also love to learn more about the claims audit process and SOPs. We have an established process with our encounter processing team, but not earlier on in the process with claims operations. So Melissa, why don't you tell us your viewpoint on those things first?
Sure. On the QBR process with SLAs, we started off with the SLAs that were in the contracts first with the vendor. So when we sign with a vendor, we obviously always want to make sure that you have strong SLAs in your contract. What do you want them to meet, whether it be timelines or quality metrics? Make sure that those are inherently in your contract first before you sign with them. And then, yes, so those are always set forth in your QBRs. Make sure they're meeting them. If they are not in your contract, make sure you're starting to just have those discussions with them within the QBRs, set KPIs with them, SLAs, whatever you want to call them, for goals, and stick with them and make sure they're both agreeable, reachable for the both. Yes. And yes, we do have them in our QBR and we do discuss them every time, whether they're going to meet them, not meet them, and how do we work collaboratively together to get them there. And then on the claim audit process, so are you, I guess, any clarification? Is it the auditing of the diagnoses? Or is it the mapping? Don, can you maybe, do you know?
Probably the mapping. The process, yeah. I would think the mapping process and, yeah. Oh, she said adjudication process.
The adjudication process. So is it the mapping adjudication process? So, yeah. So Don is actually was very helpful in that. We went through step by step. Took everything from the time a claim hit the door and went through the entire adjudication process all the way through every touch point, through all the way through the every person who touched it and every decision point where it went through any, if it went through any other person in the claims department. And all the way through the edge server. And then if it veered to any other vendor or department, whether it ended to anybody else, that's where we veered to another swim lane. So hope that answered your question. You're on mute, Don.
I'll kind of give the perspective from the kind of the vendor side of the house, just holistically. Like the audit process, I'm going to give you an example of things that are currently found during the claim audit process that SOPs need to be written for or other or things need to be addressed that are affecting that claim getting into the risk adjustment, you know, that nozzle side. So one of the health plans that I worked with that I did this leakage analysis for, we discovered that a huge amount of claims were pending for medical management reasons, meaning authorizations. There were apparently, and remember how I talked about automation and configuration in the beginning, apparently there was a configuration issue between the claims adjudication system and the medical management system that was processing referrals and authorizations. And so claims that were coming in and were authorized in terms of the services that were on in that claim and the diagnosis codes, there was a configuration issue between the systems that were dropping those claims to just an automatic pen status. It was not matching them to say, oh, you know, here's the authorization for these services. Oh, it matches the claim. Let it go on to adjudication. So, and that was costing them a lot of money. And because there were so many, a lot of them were missing the sweeps deadlines. So it was very important because there were so many to address that configuration issue. And they had to involve the vendor to do that. So it's in that, which is often not an easy process. So that's just kind of an example of the claims audit process where they were auditing each penned reason. And they started with the ones that were the highest number of pens, which for them was this medical management issue. Once they cleared that up, you know, things were flowing in a more efficient manner through their system. They didn't have that problem anymore. And so that kind of talks also to SLAs for the vendor. I always advocate when possible to give your contracts what I call teeth. So that means you can say, okay, we know that we can quantify how much volume misses risk adjustment deadlines, whether it's commercial, Medicare Advantage, Medicaid, whatever line of business you're doing, is very easy to quantify that. And so if you find that, you know, your vendor is responsible for volume missing deadlines, you can put a dollar value in that and make them share in that financial responsibility, either as an incentive or a disincentive. And so, and like Melissa said, you know, you can base it on, you know, deadlines, you can base it on missed dollars, you know, a combination of the two. It just kind of depends upon your organization's appetite and wanting that vendor to kind of feel the pain of revenue leakage issues. So hopefully, Katie, you know, our answers here answered your question. And she says, thank you. Do we have any more questions? One question that has come up is what types of tools might be used to do these types of leakage analysis? And I'm asked this a lot because this is something, of course, that I do. And it doesn't really have to be fancy. There's really no fancy tool out there. It's, you know, really just sitting down and mapping out all of those processes from start to finish. And of course, Visio is very helpful for, or a similar tool like flow charting is very helpful for that. What I do when I evaluate plans is I interview all of the stakeholders that have ownership over those processes and ask them questions about where are the KPIs and metrics that govern this process, especially if it's in claims, enrollment, provider systems, medical management, all of those constituent processes. And of course, I use just, you know, an Excel spreadsheet to record their responses and then take a look at their responses and compare it against industry best practices. So that's important too, is know what those are in risk adjustment. And certainly CMS published some back in 2018, there are 12 of them for Medicare Advantage, and a lot of them apply to commercial edge server. So it's, and they're all based upon getting that complete and accurate data. So you don't need a lot of fancy tools to do this. You know, just a willingness to, you know, map out these processes, identify those critical control points of data transfer, and apply and to quantify how much that data that's leaking is costing you. And that way you can know exactly where you need to start and where you're going to get your most bang for your buck in terms of people, processes, and technologies to address those. Do we have any other questions before we sign off for the day? We'll say last call for questions. Okay. Well, our producers have put up here on the screen a webinar experience survey. Hopefully you'll give us good marks. Please take a moment to fill that out, because that provides RISE with valuable information on what types of content you find valuable and the speakers that help you. So please take a moment, you know, to fill that out. We've got two questions here. Actually, we've got more, a little more than that, I think. Three questions. Take a moment to answer those. And we hope that you have found today's webinar helpful. It was Melissa and I's pleasure to be able to present for you today. And we appreciated our time with you at RISE National. We certainly appreciated this additional opportunity to share more valuable information with you about data governance. So thank you on behalf of RISE and Melissa and myself and Centauri.